Here at the Midwest LSA Expo in Mount Vernon, Illinois, we've had the chance to fly the World Aircraft, and this is now called the Vision Sport. Let's put this airplane in its position within the fleet of LSA. This is a definite mid-range priced airplane, and this is well below $100,000. So it's a very affordable airplane. Let's call it that. This airplane is powered by the Rotax 912 engine, which gives it quite good performance. And that spins this nicely curved and American-made Sensenic propeller, a new three-blade they put on it. And they're saying it improves in performance in every category. Better climb rate, better cruise. And better cruise, it's getting 3 or 4 knots, Chris told me, as we flew around today. So that's a nice improvement from a new prop they've got on the airplane. You notice this airplane is, it's a lot of glass or plexiglass. Basically, with a tapered instrument panel as it does, it gets smaller to you in the cockpit. Therefore, you can see around the edges of the instrument panel. And here's where you're looking out, and you can almost see down to the runway here, almost right in front of you, but it makes the visibility huge. A few more points about this Vision Sport. On both sides of the fuselage, both sides of the engine cowl here, you've got a door that's this wide. I'm drawing my fingers around it to make sure you can see it all. Same on the other side. Now you've got a fairly large opening, kind of like a hood on a car, that will allow you to inspect, certainly, but also to physically do some work. That's a fairly large opening. Now, of course, you can take the cowl off too, as it shows here. I'm guessing that's a little bit more work. This would be pretty quick and easy, and in a flight school environment where you want to check things regularly or show students around the airplane, that'd be real nice. Steerable nose wheel. Also, this airplane has differential braking on it. Of course, it's only differential braking on the left seat side, the main pilot side. So as I flew in the right side, I did not get to experience the braking on it, but it is differential braking. Nice sturdy gear here, Matco wheels and brakes, and very sturdy main gear. That thing is going to handle some serious pounding. So it has a slightly thicker airfoil, which allows it to carry a little more fuel because the area, the volume is larger there, so this can hold 28 gallons. The higher priced, more deluxe airplane holds 24 gallons. Still gonna give you quite a bit of flying time, but along the leading edge here, these little translucent plastic things, these are vortex generators. These help improve the airflow by slightly turbulating the air over the wing and allows it to operate at a slower speed. Indeed, we saw stall speed well down into the 30s, and that's miles per hour. So, and going all the way down here to the end, we have to show you the wingtip treatment because it's quite interesting. If you sight your camera right down the edge here, you're going to see not just a droop tip, but a nicely turned tip. It looks good, and of course, that kind of thing generally does keep the air moving in the way that it should so that you get less wingtip disturbance, which gives you a little bit of what they call more effective span. And if you can bring your camera all the way around in the back, you'll see they've also got some what are sometimes called spanwise flow controllers here, all right at the tip these are oriented. This is all an attempt to control airflow at the tip so you have less wingtip action going on here, which creates drag. What we saw at the wingtip is recreated out here on the edge of the horizontal stabilizer. And you see that same effect because although this is much smaller than the main wing, the same action still occurs. And some other nice execution here. On the end of the elevator here, you can see that they've actually enlarged the surface back here. And the purpose is that this aids airflow. It doesn't create, of course it creates a little bit of drag, but it aids the airflow, makes the surface actually more effective. A final thing to point out while we're back here at the tail, rudder trim. This is electric powered rudder trim and electric powered elevator trim. You got a lock right here so you can keep people out of the airplane when you're not around it. And a latch that releases there's a similar latch inside the airplane as well, so that you have this last bracket here as it grabs on that. But then when you're inside, you'll move this lever forward, which is going to grasp the bracket right at the bottom here by my hand. And so it makes the door very nice and secure. You also notice, let me close the door just for a moment, it goes well forward. The rudder pedal is literally right there, so your foot is only pulled in a couple of inches from the rudder pedal, one of two things that makes this aircraft a very easy entry. So step right up, entry, sit down in the seat, easy to do. The entry height is low enough for most people, except very short folks. Push the stick over to the side, 1 foot across the stick, and then the other one inside, and then you can bring the stick back up. Now, you notice I brought the stick up. That means it's a folding stick. There's a mechanism right down here. There's a collar, which you bring up, and then you push this clasp tight around it, and now the rudder, the stick is in the right position that it should be in. So now that I'm fully seated and have I put the stick back down again, but there it is in the normal position. But look at this here. I have my leg almost straight and I can get it in and out. Now I'm just of average height. A really tall guy might have to pull back a little bit, but this makes for a very easy entry right here. So that's a nice feature. Also, look at this seat. And if you can bring your camera over here a little bit, you'll see that my feet are right now 4 or 5 inches short of the rudder pedals. This seat is back so far. A really tall guy, I don't know, 6'6 or something would fit in here easily. And moving the seat, no problem in flight. There's a handle, which we'll show you in a minute, but I'm gonna grasp that handle now. It's a nice sturdy welded point. There's a lever right here by my hand, and I just flip that lever to the outside of the airplane, and I can slide forward, and look at that range now. I can go up so far now that even at my average height, I'm almost bumping, but not quite bumping the panel, but now I've got an easy reach. In fact, I've brought it more forward than I need to now. On the left side, we have tow brakes here. I could easily work those now in this position, but I don't need quite that much, so I'm gonna come back here and a little bit more. Again, you can do this in flight, so no problem in flight. Well, I'm seated in here now. I've adjusted the seats as we just showed you, and I'm in a comfortable position for me. The reach to the pedals is now comfortable. If you can shine your camera down here, you can see right underneath here, which actually gives you a little more leg room if you wanted to wiggle your feet or something. But now you can see the rudder pedals on each side there. I'm just pointing them out with my left foot. And right above that is the braking for, so differential braking. However, the seats, they look kind of thin and insubstantial perhaps, but in flying in the airplane for about 45 minutes with Chris, I got out of the airplane and didn't notice anything. Now for me, that's a pretty good cue. I've got a little bit of a sensitive back, and if I get out of an airplane that doesn't have comfortable seats in it, I'll know it within minutes, much less almost an hour. So I judge these seats to be quite comfortable. This is an airplane that flies about 100 miles an hour. That's miles an hour, not knots, so that's about 87 knots or so. So it's not the fastest airplane in the sky, but it has the visibility that I just can't say enough about it. Behind me here, I'm reaching back as far as I can, and I can't even get to the second level, what's sometimes called a hat rack here, and carpeted to keep noise down a little bit. I find it to be a very acceptable airplane in many ways, even little features like a place to put your headsets where they're right in place where you want them. All the plug-ins for the headsets are in the back so you don't have wires running back and forth in the cockpit. But let's just do a sweep upward here. I'm gonna go by the throttle, which I'm not gonna move it here because we're not running the engine, but there's no friction lock on it, as is common in light sport aircraft. The friction within the system keeps the throttle right where it's at. I notice no throttle creep whatsoever. Right alongside the throttle, on the left side is the wing flap mechanism, or the operation, it's electric, and there's rudder trim, which is electric, and on the stick right here, I'm pointing at the elevator trim, which is very sensible, trim nose down, trim nose up, and it's marked that way as well with nice little markings, so it's very clear, and up here on the panel, you see three electronic lighting systems that tell you the wing flap position, the rudder trim position, and the elevator trim position. In addition, you got some of your switches and circuit breakers here and so forth. You've got your choke, an airbox heat that's for the engine, and cabin heat for the occupants. Over here, we have a series of dials flanking the Garmin radio. The dials, you notice, take up very little space on here, and that's because there's three in each, as you can see. That made them a little small. I didn't notice things quite as quickly because the letters are physically a little bit small. On the outside of the instrument panel, this nicely tapered instrument panel that we told you about earlier, you've got two what might be called eye-stalk air inlets. They swivel all the way around and let air go all over the place, and they adjust for volume of air as well. So that's really kind of a nice set of features to this airplane. Makes it quite comfortable inside. We talked about systems a little bit earlier. We talked about the joystick. I love the folding joystick, but you know, no solution is absolutely perfect. You can't see it too well here, but let me show you on this side. It gets kind of close to the panel there, so you're going to have to exercise just a little bit of caution when you put this up. Now, it's easy to move it to the side here. As I move it to the side, you can see the control motions here. If you go to the side, there's no issue at all. However, they said they were going to expand the panel some more, so that may be something they have to take into consideration. They might even have to put in a slightly shorter joystick, which they could. But the seating position, the cabin comfort, I told you about the seats already. The joystick position is great. There is not much of a armrest here. You do have something on the door handle you could rest your arm on, but there's really no need to be doing any of that while you're flying the airplane, because I just rested my arm in my lap and moved the joystick. The motions are very small, about like I'm showing you right now. That did all of the controls we need. The controls are slightly on the heavy side, but you know, people like different kinds of things. I happen to like lighter sticks. I don't mind that, but a lighter stick in turbulent conditions can have you kind of wallowing around the sky if you're not careful. A little heavier stick is more comfortable to a beginning pilot because the action is not quite so immediate, and yet the forces were not so high. There's just a little bit of, you might call it friction in the system that resists you a little bit, and for some people, that's highly desirable. So the airplane is an established design now because it's got established people behind it. Both World Aircraft and Spirit, the more deluxe model, and Vision, the more affordable model, they're new. You haven't seen any of those names for too many years, but the people behind the company, a lot of experience, so there's a lot to rely on there. And they're clearly capable of executing very well there in Paris, Tennessee. Let's talk a little bit about flying for a moment. When we cruised around, at one point I had the airplane set at about 5,000 engine RPM. That's fairly low. This is a Rotax engine where that number is basically kind of a low cruise speed number. That produced in the mid-80s, and we're talking miles an hour here. At 5,300, 5,400, somewhere in there, which is still not full power, but maybe at 75-80%, now we're seeing about 100, and that again is miles per hour, so that's about 87 knots. Stall speed was almost absurdly low. Those VGs we showed you earlier on the wing and the thickness of the wing clearly contributing to its slow speed. I saw visually on the instrumentation mid-30s, and that's miles an hour, before we saw a stall. That's low 30s in knots. And when we did, the airplane just wallowed a little bit. There was the most subtle indications of being in a stall. I lowered the nose just slightly, added a little bit of power, and we were right back to 60, 70 miles an hour, well beyond stall speed. As we came into land, we came over the runway, and Chris gave me the following instructions, which worked out very well. I had a nice touchdown on the airplane. We crossed over the runway, entered downwind, got 80 miles an hour. At that point, we can begin to put down flaps and other things. So then as we turned onto base leg, we brought it down to 70 miles an hour and added the 20 degrees of flaps that make for a normal landing. There are more flaps than that. That's just a landing flap. Finally, as we came in on final, got it down to 60 miles an hour as we crossed over the numbers. And from there, I quit paying attention to airspeed and started looking out this wonderful visibility and just kind of felt my way down. I would guess touchdown came at something like 50 miles an hour. Again, that's miles an hour. That would be about 45 knots, something like that. So quite a slow landing speed. Touchdown went very well. I handed the airplane back over to Chris, who was in the left seat because he had the brakes, and we concluded our flight. So that's a lot of information about the World Aircraft Company, designer Max Tedesco, main proprietor Eric Giles and his whole team, and thanks to Chris for his flying with me today, a 13,000-hour pilot, in case you didn't pick up on that earlier, about 10 hours in this particular vision, clearly a man at one with his flying machinery. We thank all of them. You can get more information about this airplane and many other light sport aircraft on my website, bydanjohnson.com or bydanjohnson.com. Thanks a lot for joining us here at the Midwest LSA Expo.